Are you hearing God's voice? Are you having a hard time hearing God's voice? I mean, it's not like you have a burning bush in your backyard or you're getting a spiritual download, or you can just go have a mountaintop experience where you can go to camp with your friends and then come back feeling rejuvenated. No, none of those things are happening. And so it's really up to you and your own personal time with God to become exhilarating. And if your Bible time and your time with God is anything less than exhilarating, perhaps there are three frequency blockers that are keeping you from hearing God's voice in this season. I use the term frequency with massive intentionality because our hearts are tuned to God, much like your modem is tuned to, you know, Time Warner cable, right? There are invisible frequency waves that are connecting to Time Warner and that it's received by your modem. You don't see it, but you know the effects of it. Similarly, your heart was initially tuned to God, but because of sin, it was tuned to ourselves. For instance, it would be like your heart is tuned to, you know, 66.6 FM, right? And all it wants to do is serve itself. And so even if you do good things, right, you can do good things for the wrong reasons, they're still wrong in God's eyes. So you can do good things for selfish reasons because that's the tune of your heart. Now, when you become a Christian, you get a new heart. It tunes your heart dial to 77.7, where you no longer want what you want, now you want the things of God. And even if the good things on this side of Jesus looks like the good things on the other side of Jesus, your heart dial has been retuned to a new frequency. Now, there are three frequency blockers that keep us from hearing God's voice. The first one is the Bible. See, sometimes we complain about not being able to hear God's voice. Well, I always say you can't complain about not hearing the voice of God if your Bible is shut. Rick Warren says it this way: praying is you talking to God, but reading the Bible is God talking to you. See, in 2 Timothy 3:16, it says, "For all scripture is God-breathed." So when you read the Bible, you're actually reading the very breath of God speaking to you. Now, the interesting thing about the breath of God is that the more you consume it, the more your breath starts smelling like the breath of God. I know, that sounds weird. I'm talking about Bible breath. See, Bible breath is when you consume the things of God so much that you don't even know that you're quoting Bible verses sometimes. And you just end up spewing out psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, and you're just making music to the Lord in your heart. But it just comes out of you when you are talking because your mind and your heart has been so saturated by God's word that people can just smell it on you. They can trust you. But the reality is that we spend a lot of time listening to politics, and then what comes out of our mouth is politics breath. And maybe we spend a lot of time listening to the things on social media, and what comes out is social media breath. But my encouragement to you is that you would be so saturated by God's word that when you open your mouth, you know what? The things of God comes out, and you have Bible breath. So one of the frequency blockers in your life may be the fact that your Bible is shut, and we can't expect to hear God's word. We can't expect to hear God's voice if our Bible is shut. The second frequency blocker in our life may be the fact of we are not confessing our known sins to God. See, if there was one prayer in the Bible that God always answers, it's always, "God, show me my sin and lead me into everlasting." See, David in Psalm 139 said, "Search me and know me, O God, and then lead me into the way of everlasting." That is one prayer that God always answers. If you ever wanted to get an answer from God for anything in your life, you can always ask, "God, is there any sin in my life that I just need to get rid of?" Guaranteed, the answers will start flowing and the voice will start coming. So some of the frequency blockers that we talked about so far is the fact that we might not be reading God's word and that we might have unconfessed sin in our life. But the third and final one that we're gonna talk about today is the reality that maybe we have some bitterness in our life. There's somebody in our life that we need to forgive. And God takes forgiveness very seriously because he wants to offer us mercy, but sometimes we are not willing to grant it to others. See, Jesus talks about how important forgiveness is in Matthew chapter 18, verses 21 through 35, when he talks about the king and a servant. Right, the king was settling accounts in his kingdom, right? Much like God will one day with us. and he calls the servant to give an account for what he's done with his resources. And that servant owes the king 10,000 talents. Now, you may not know what a 10,000 talents is or what $10,000, but the illustration, the parable only works if you understand the amount of debt that the servant was in. See, 10,000 talents is the equivalent to $300 billion, right? This is a debt that will take multiple lifetimes to pay back. And so that servant is about to get judged because that servant deserves to die but back then they don't kill people right away for debt. What they do is they enslave them, and if they can't pay the debt off, they enslave their family. And so the servant pleads with the king, saying, please have mercy on me. The word in Greek is makrothuma. Be long suffering. Makro means long. Thuma means temper. Be long-tempered, as opposed to don't have a short temper, have a long temper with me. Give me a few days and I'll pay it back. That's what the servant says. The king knows that he can never pay back this debt. So what does the king do? The king says, yes, I will be macro thuma, and I will have mercy on you, and I will show grace on you. Instead of giving you justice, I will give you mercy. Your debt has been forgiven. I will absorb the responsibility of the debt you owe, and you will be forgiven. Boom. The servant is off. He's happy. He's excited. But as the servant goes along his way, he finds somebody else who owes him money. The servant finds another person who owes him money. But the amount of debt means is pennies compared to the $300 billion that he owed the other king. And so, you know what it was? It was only, the Bible says it was like $3,000, right? The equivalent of $3,000. But instead of the servant having mercy, he then leverages his rights to enact judgment on his fellow servant. And then he has his fellow servant thrown into debtor's prison. And he does not show long suffering. He does not show patience. He does not show mercy to the other servant. So when the king found out about this, he decided to confront the unmerciful servant. And he says this in Matthew 18, 32 through 33. Then the master called the servant in. You wicked servant, he said. I canceled all your debt because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have mercy on your fellow servant just as I had on you? The answer is yes. See, this is a parable. See, parables are illustrations that have dramatic consequences to our reality today. Jesus is trying to give us a picture of what it's like in heaven. See, God forgave us of a great debt that we couldn't pay off altogether. So instead of calling us to account for it, instead of us paying the penalty for it, he let Jesus pay the penalty for it so that we can experience grace. See, what God was doing was showing us macro thuma, lots of patience. So in turn, we should be patient and forgiving and merciful to those around us. So what happens when we're not forgiving, when we're not merciful? Stay tuned. It says right here in Matthew 18, 34 through 35. In anger, his master handed him over to the jailers to be tortured until he should pay back all he owed, which will be never, right? He'll never be able to pay back what he owed. The reality is forgiveness locks other people out and locks you in. And guess what? You're just torturing yourself. I've heard it said this way. When we choose not to forgive somebody else, that's like drinking rat poison and expecting the other person to die. If you want justice, if you're the kind of person who's hot on justice and you want justice from those around you, well, justice is what you'll get. But if you're the kind of person who wants mercy from God our Father and mercy for those around us, well, then mercy is what you get. See, the kind of grace, the kind of mercy that God extends to us, he expects us to extend to other people. And so our lives should be marked by mercy. And when we don't have mercy in our life and we have bitterness and unforgiveness in our lives, it blocks the frequency of God from having the power that it needs so that it can transform your life. When I first started working at the Church of Rocky Peak, I remember this one guy. He was struggling with his relationships, with making decisions on what school he wanted to go to, or what job he was going to get into, or what was happening with his family. And he just wanted to know, what's God's will for my life? What is God's will for my life? What does God want me to do? And I said, the answer to that question is really simple. And it starts with this. Is there anybody in your life that you need to forgive? Start there, because God is more concerned with your bitterness and your resentment with the people around you than he is with these other decisions. God loves you too much to let broken relationships live in your life. He wants to restore the relationship with you personally, but he also wants to restore the relationships between you and the you next to you, and the you behind you, and the you in front of you, and the you that lives in your house, or the you that you work with, or the you that you're dating, or the you that you just broke up with. Forgiveness is a big deal. So much so that it can block your ability to hear God's voice. If you're hearing God's voice, I want to remind you three things. Let's get into God's word, because that may be the very thing you need so that you can unlock the will of God in your life. Number two, explore if there's any unconfessed sin in your life. And number three, is there anybody that you need to release from the responsibility of the debt that they owe you? And may you hear God's voice this week. I love you. We're praying for you. I'll see you soon.